a young buck, dare I say, back then. And what are your memories of your guest appearance as Sheriff Newman on the A-Team?
James, thank you for having me on. It was great. It was simply great. I was only 8 years old when I played Sheriff Newman. That's a joke because it has been a long time. It was great. It was first class. I my scene was with George Peppard and the other great cast members. The whole operation, everything was a class act, and it was just a thrill. To have a scene. It was with Tracy Scoggins, a young, stunning, really brilliant actress. It was her first TV show, I think her first TV show or film. And she was an engine in this specific episode. She drove, she was the one who had the problem. And then there were complications. And then there's the resolution, the basic structure of it. And she was terrific. And I came in through the door, and there's George Peppard sitting over there to my right, and all the other Dwight and I'm going up on the other gentleman.
Mr. T and Dirk.
Well, Mr. T was in the back having his foot attended to because he had stepped on a nail and he was getting a tetanus shot and everything. But I did work with Mr. T the previous year, actually in 1981, his first. Which is a film I was in called Penitentiary 2. That was his first movie. It was a fight movie in a jail, in a prison. And it was a hit. It's a cult hit now. So I had met him before. So it was great working on this as well to see him.
Okay, and Gerald, obviously the main bad guy in this episode was the character Garber, played by John Quaid. And in the terms of guest stars and guest actors coming on an A-Team for an episode, did the guest stars, did you sort of click? Did you sort of intermingle? Did the guest stars spend time with each other? Did you get to rub acquaintances with John Quaid?
Well, it would only be at lunch. This was a bit unusual, but it happens and you just roll with the punches. I showed up at 6 a.m. that morning, and I think my scene was the last one they did of the day, which was probably around 6 p.m. or 7 p.m. And they shoot. So I only really just got to mix while we were having lunch. Otherwise, I was in my dressing space. They have a little dressing room, portable. Usually,
And
but sometimes.
the whole lunch experience, I heard on the A-Team that it was fairly frenetic, that Mr. T sort of was boisterous during those canteen lunch breaks in terms of food and in terms of cracking jokes, novelty. And Dirk Schultz was Dwight Schultz was full of life as well, while Dirk Benedict was a bit more calm, quiet, kept to himself. And George, depending on what sort of mood he was in terms of depicted his sort of day. And what was your sort of experience around lunchtime on the set of the 18?
It wasn't boisterous at all. It was very harmonious and just a little and witty and a little George Peppard, working with him, my gosh, what a thrill. And to meet him, and even in at a lunch break, I mean, he's an icon. He was Breakfast at Tiffany's with Audrey Hepburn. Doesn't get any better than that. And his whole style and all of them. It's an amazing mix of charismatic. Each character, each actor, they're charismatic and they're pros. And so there was nothing but harmony. And it's part of the thing I love about show business is the harmony. It's ensemble. It's the same as a jazz band or a classical orchestra or a Broadway show, or any acting show for that matter. And it's ensemble. And so it's all just little quips here and there. And are you really going to eat that? All of that? Yeah, joke, joke. So they were all great. They were absolutely great.
And I noticed there, Gerald, just looking back in terms of doing my research, just you appeared in a number of Stephen Cannell productions, if I'm right, during the 80s.
I honestly don't know. I don't have my credits in front of me. He did like six or seven great series. I was never on the one with James Garner,
Rockford
The
Files.
Rockford Files. But I actually did live about a mile down the beach from him in an old trailer myself. Funny as that is, up there on Point Doom, it's called. People say Dume, but it's Point Doom. It was a great. And then his shooting down at Paradise Cove, right there on the Pacific Ocean, was not that far. And he was another just totally class act. I had never worked with him, but just observing his career and everything, he was the real deal. He had been awarded. In World War II, he had been in World War II, and he had got a Purple Heart, and so he was the real. And he could play any role. He was amazing.
And I suppose, Gerald, in this episode, there's always a catch. There's almost like a Captain Hook sort of feel to this sort of episode, where this sort of let's say, dare I say, invasion at sea, in terms of this sort of a family business. This sort of, it's got the real hometown sort of, real sort of country sort of feel to it. A small family, a fishing business, trying to make ends meet, and then someone just trying to be the bully, dare I say. It's not a arcade, it's not brawn, it's not a beat 'em up, it's not massive artillery. It's just something so soft, so simple, but so compelling to watch all the same.
I think that's exactly right. It was a kinder, gentler drama with action, with a lot of action. All that, the couple of fight sequences, they're all choreographed by a fight director. You know, that it's like a ballet in a way. You know every move. There's no, it's called stage force. That's what it, from the stage, you learn the same thing. And it has an innocence, and it has humor, and it has wit, and then it has the action. For me, it these episodes are the perfect escapist kind of come home from work, relax, sit down, see these wonderful actors in dramas, and where there's jeopardy. And but it's not mean-spirited, it's not gratuitous, it's not going over the line like we see so much now. And that's part of the reason for its success. And it was the diversity of the characters too, the men, the women. It was great when Mr. T came on to that. He was a very remarkable man, because I got to know him pretty well on Penitentiary too. He was a real people person. He knew, he was very bright. And so that was so it had a great mix. And obviously Stephen Cannell, it comes from him. He loved actors. He actually did some acting. People research it, they'll see he did a number of shows. So he loved acting, and he wrote novels. He and his set was just clean and orderly and tight. Everything, like that costume I wore, I remember that it fit like a glove. It was as good a costume, and I had that hat. And that's helpful for actors to get into the role, is to have something so specific and so perfect. It's perfectly fitted to me. And that was just one of those attention to details that people who just love the industry and really love actors, and he did.
And I suppose, Jerry, in terms of the character Sheriff Newman, and I know obviously you don't remember the sort of lines and the sort of stuff, but in terms of the premise, what was your idea in terms of how you wanted to portray him, if you can remember it? Did you just wanted to portray him as the normal country town police cop, the normal police officer that just goes around doing his day-to-day business and not looking for any commotion or trouble? Or did you want to show him as a stricter side of the law?
We have different approaches, what they call the method, the technique. It's an approach of exactly what you're saying, how to get into the character, how to break down the script and make those kinds of choices. So for me, it was, I learned there was a, one of the great acting teachers was a Sanford Meisner, and he was part of the group theater in the 30s. And then I learned from one of his students named Charles Conrad. And so what you do is you absorb, you break down the script as what you, you know, have your motive, quote, motivation, what are you after in this? But then when you walk in the, you know, action, and I walk in the door and I turn around and I look at Tracy, her character, you just do whatever is natural and whatever comes up emotionally or just whatever. And I looked at it. I hadn't looked at it in a long time. And I looked at it this obviously the last few days, and I was soft spoken. And I just listened to her. I was just glued to her. And then I just responded just like I'm talking now without forethought or anything. And that's the fun of it. I had one friend, what you do is you jump out of a plane without a parachute and you just go. But that's the beauty, the fun of it. And I found that looking at it, that was a perfect, I give myself a little pat on the back. She's a stunning young woman who's in trouble. So there's no reason to come in boisterous or trying to put forth my, I'm the authority figure here. You better answer the questions correct that I'm asking you. It was very soft, and that was appropriate for a young woman in trouble like that. And I didn't figure that out. I just did it because it was just what was in front of me. And it's really the great joy. And all those actors, however they train, they all do that. They're all in the moment, and they go for that look for that spontaneous thing because it's real. You don't know what you're going to do. I know where I'm going to move. I know when I took off my hat, and that sort of thing.
And I suppose, Gerald, having appeared in the A-Team live cable show that went out all across America and Canada November the 15th, 1983, and I know you had appeared in other guest episodes in various shows throughout the 80s, but at the time, did you realize the significance of having a role in the A-Team? Did you actually watch, do you remember, did you actually watch your own episode when it came out live with family, friends, loved ones? And did it open up doors or opportunities for you later on in the 80s, having appeared on the A-Team, do you think?
You know, it's a great question. It's I did look at it, and I ended up the next in 83, I shot Beverly Hills Cop, the first one with Eddie Murphy. And I had three scenes with him. I played a cop. I played a policeman. I was Beverly Hills Cop number one. I had, and he gets thrown through the glass window. I drive in a police car, Bill, I'm going up on Bill's name here. Bill Wallace, what a wonderful actor. So we were both kind of Boy Scout like Beverly Hills, do it by the numbers, very, very courteous, move to the side of the car, please. And that it did help. It absolutely did help. I mean, three scenes with Eddie Murphy, and that was the largest grossing comedy in film history at that time. 1984 came out. It was a huge hit. Marty Brest was the director. He's a great director. And then I played some other roles as a policeman too, but it was also the A-Team, that episode I was in. I was a co-star. Co-star is a big deal. I did a co-star with Joni Lefchachi, and but there for coming up actors, it's a big deal. It puts you into another level. It moves you up. So that's absolutely correct.
And Jerry, before I start to touch on the final question to summarize your time and memories on the A-Team, what's life like for you now, Jerry Berns, and what's everything like in the world for you at the moment, and how do you spend your time these days?
I want to just clarify. I'm Gerald Berns. But that's okay. It's B E R N S. There's another actor named Jerry Berns, and he's B U R N S. He's a J E R E. He's a great actor. He's done a ton of work. He's been a working actor since he came out here. He's a terrific actor. So he's Jerry Berns. I'm Gerald. What's happened? I had a really prominent, small but very prominent role in The Net with Sandra Bullock. I'm the mystery of the whole movie, Jeff Gregg, and that's a thrill. But I've become a writer, and I'm back in going back even to 1980. My first 80, I wrote my first screenplay. In 82, I had a meeting at 20th Century Fox, and I've written a bunch of scripts, and I've had options, and I've had agents and man, the whole deal. And most recently, I've written a novel called Stars. So, sale here on Amazon, and it's got a 5-star review from the reader's favorite book contest and book reviews, and won a finalist award with the Next Generation Indie Book Award. So that's my first novel. So I've become a novelist, and I've been a screenwriter for a long time, and knock on wood, some really good activities going on now with all that as well. So it's just, I just see the acting and the writing as cousins, close cousins, and using your imagination and coming up through the ranks. But I've been mostly writing for quite a bit now.
Okay. Fantastic. Gerald Berns, for the final sort of 30 seconds, I'm going to turn it over to you, and you might enlighten us in terms of describing your time, your experience on the A-Team. You appeared on November the 15th, 1983, season 2, episode 9, There's Always a Catch. You played the character Sheriff Newman. If you could sum up your experience on the A-Team in two sentences, what would you like those two sentences to read?
I would say it was a top tier experience. The set, the company, the group of actors, they were all wonderful. It was an experience that is when you come to Hollywood, you hope to have.
Okay. On that note, Gerald Berns, thanks for joining us this evening to share your memories of the A-Team. No doubt, many treasured memories shared from the past and many more treasured memories to come. We do wish you all the best with the success of your novel. We do advise all our listeners and all our audience to go on Amazon to do purchases straight away. No doubt it'll be a great read for you and all family and for all loved ones. But for the moment, from me, Jim Conlan, to you, Gerald Berns, stay safe, take care, and God bless, sir.
Likewise. Thank you so much. You
be
well. Take care.